The fiery rescue on the highway in New York, strangers running from their vehicles towards a burning car, reaching into the flames to save a woman trapped inside. ABC's Mara Schiavo-Campo with the chaos on the road.
Tonight, newly released dashcam video of a massive highway accident and an amazing rescue. Watch as the crash unfolds in a split second. A tractor trailer barreling through a line of cars, causing this 10-car pileup.
Tractor trailer over an SUV that's on fire.
Inside this white car on the shoulder, a woman is trapped. Construction workers and other motorists rush to her aid. Complete strangers desperate to save her.
It's completely quiet. We have several cars on fire. We have several people entrapped.
As the Good Samaritans try the door, flames erupt on the passenger side. But they don't give up, using a fire extinguisher to put out the blaze, finally pulling the woman out through the window. Miraculously, she suffered only cuts and bruises, and no one was killed. Now, even the mayor has posted the video to his Facebook page, thanking these unsung heroes. Mara Schiavo-Campo, ABC News, New York.
We would say that that person was saved, right? That she was rescued. I mean, she was taken from death to life, in a sense. You say, well, why are we starting a sermon with that video? Well, really, in a sense, that's a picture, that's an illustration of what we're going to talk about today, because we're going to talk about what the Bible says about being saved, about salvation, and see that that's a picture of it, because the word save means to rescue or to deliver. It's to rescue someone from death and bring them to life. And just like that person was saved in a physical sense, the cross was God's great rescue mission. Jesus came to save us, to rescue us from our sins, to deliver us from death to life. Now, if you grew up in church, or if you grew up in East Tennessee, I guess, maybe whether or not you grew up in church, you've heard the word or different forms or variations of the word saved. Right? You need to get saved. You need to be born again. Or you need to get born again in some areas of East Tennessee. Maybe somebody's told you that at some point. And sometimes, though, I think we're guilty. I'm sure I try not to, but I'm sure I do this sometimes when I preach or when I talk to people. But church people, sometimes it's like we've got our own vocabulary, right? And I think sometimes, honestly, and I mean, I'm a pastor, I think sometimes we just got to sound weird to people. Like, amen, hallelujah, brother. Right? I mean, I didn't never call my brother brother, you know, I called him by his name. Not there's anything wrong with that, but, you know, sometimes we can have our own vocabulary. We can use, you know, these words that nobody else knows what we're talking about. And I think sometimes when it comes to the word save or salvation or born again or, you know, different aspects, words that are related to salvation, maybe sometimes we assume knowledge that people don't necessarily have. Like, you can say to some people, you need to get saved. They have no clue what you're talking about. Or sometimes people have even been in church and they don't know what it is. I mean, you know, I've encountered people who thought they were saved because they walked down an aisle. People who thought they were saved because somebody prayed for them. Maybe, you know, the worst example that I've ever encountered is I led a lady to Christ in my office one time who thought she was saved because she thought a preacher had saved her. Now, that guy shouldn't even be in the ministry, right? And so what I'm saying is, you know, saved is a common word. You know, we know just kind of the normal usage or meaning of it. To rescue, to deliver. Maybe we don't really understand what it is in a spiritual sense. And so the title of the message today is simply Saved. And so that's what we're going to talk about. And we're going to focus on one verse in Ephesians, really verses 8 through 10 go together. But for time's sake, I'm going to try to unpack verse 8 today and then verses 9 and 10 next week. And really, verses 1 through 10 all go together. So, here's what I hope that we'll get today. I hope that you'll come out of this. Two things. One, that you'll really understand what it means to be saved, that won't just be a word to you, but it'll mean something to you. But beyond just intellectually being able to define a word, that you'll come out of this time today knowing that you are saved, knowing where you stand with God. So, verse was on the screen before, but let's just read it again. For by grace you have been saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. And if you go back to what we've already read, we looked at a couple weeks ago, verses 1 through 6, that we need salvation because we're all dead in our trespasses and sins. We're under the wrath of God, but God, in His love, in His grace, in His mercy, intervened to make us alive in Christ. Last week, we learned that the ultimate purpose of salvation is what? The glory of God. So the only possible means of salvation is what? The grace of God. And so Paul then begins here to unpack that in even more detail in verse 8. The first word of verse 8 is the word for, which means because, or literally it's saying, you know, this is why I'm telling you this. Everything I've said before is leading up to this, and now I want you to see that by grace you're saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. So I want to give you three basic statements that I think define what this verse is saying about salvation for us, and try to unpack them, help us to understand them, and apply them to our lives. So, number one, salvation is to be rescued from death to life. Salvation is to be rescued from death to life. Why do I say this? Two reasons. Number one, it's what I've said. The word save, the basic definition of it is to rescue or to deliver. And in the context here, what we see is, you know, the first five verses here are, you know, you're dead, but now He's made you alive. In fact, if you look in verse 5, Aaron, if you'll stick that on the screen for a second, if we go back there for a second, he says, even when we were dead in trespasses, He made us alive together with Christ. And then you notice it's in parentheses, it's inserted in here, by grace you have been saved. So it's like He made this statement, you went from death to life by grace, and now He comes back to it in verse 8 to pick up on it and to elaborate on it. So, if we're going to be saved, if we're going to understand this, we have to first of all understand our spiritual condition, that all of us, no matter what we look like outwardly, no matter where we are, no matter how moral or religious or immoral or irreligious we are, that we're spiritually dead because of our sin, and we need to be rescued from those sins and brought to life, and the only way that can happen is by the grace of God. Let me give you an illustration of this. In 1875, a man by the name of Dr. Charles Berry became pastor of St. George's Road Congregational Church in Bolton, England. It was a large church. The building seated about 1,200 people. But Dr. Berry was somewhat liberal in his theology. And what I mean by that was, in his preaching, instead of focusing on Jesus as our Savior, he focused on the life of Christ, and he focused on Jesus as our example. Of course, Jesus is our example, but that's, you know, the Bible says He came to seek and save that which was lost. It doesn't say He came to set an example for us. He did that. That's just not the primary thing. Well, shortly after he got there, a young girl came to see him one day, kind of frantic. She obviously looked very poor, very disheveled, ill-dressed, so to speak. But she came to him and basically begged him to come to her house with her because she said that her mother was about to die, and she wanted to talk to a preacher because she needed someone to help her get right with God and help her to get prepared to face God and to go into eternity. So he went with her and traveled with her to one of the worst parts of Bolton, England, and went in this home that where obviously these people had lived a life of poverty, a life of struggle. And so he began to attempt to minister to this lady on her deathbed. And so out of his theology, he began to speak to her about the beautiful life of Jesus and how Jesus was a great example for us and how he was a great leader. And at one point, this lady on her deathbed interrupted and said to him, "Mister, that's no good for me. I've lived an awful sinful life, and I don't want no example, but I do want a Savior. Can you tell me of the Savior and how He can come and get me in?" And at that moment, you know, in just one of these, you know, sometimes we have these moments in life where of clarity, where we see something the way it really needs to be seen. And this was that moment for him, and he saw the error of his preaching, that he had been preaching Jesus as an example instead of Jesus as a Savior. But the reality of the matter was, this man wasn't actually a Christian himself. You know, being a preacher won't get you into heaven. And at that moment, he is like, you know, what can I tell this woman? And so he begins to think back to his childhood and his godly, believing parents and what they had taught him about Jesus. And he began to share the gospel, the good news with her of the fact that Jesus is God who left heaven and came to earth, born of the Virgin Mary, and of His love for us and His perfect example. But His example isn't enough to save us because we've all fallen short and we've all sinned. But how Jesus went to the cross bearing our sin, dying in our place, suffering our punishment, rising from the dead to give us new life and to give us eternal life in a resurrected, glorified body. And He shared this with this lady. And after a few hours, this lady died, but she died rejoicing in Jesus Christ as her Savior, not her example, prepared to meet Him in eternity. And Dr. Berry summarized that experience by saying this. He said, "I got her in, and I got in myself." Because in that moment, he believed the gospel for himself. Listen, at the end of the day, we don't need an example. We need a Savior. There's at least two reasons that Jesus' example can't save us. Number one, none of us can, have, or will ever follow His example, because His example was perfect sinlessness. So, we haven't followed His example. And second, if we've not followed His example, and we are sinners, even if we spend the rest of our lives trying to follow His example, how's that going to get rid of our sin? We need a Savior. A dead person can't follow Jesus' example. Dead person can't do anything, right? If we're spiritually dead, we can't do any good works. Salvation is to be rescued from death to life. Now, we want to go just a little bit deeper with this before we move on and talk about the grace of God, though. Because when we read the word salvation in the New Testament, I don't think we get its fullness. Okay? If we did a poll and I asked most of you to define salvation, I feel very confident in saying the majority of you would say it means to be forgiven of your sins. To have a relationship with God. Something along those lines. But that's true, but it actually means a whole lot more than that. Because when you see the word save or salvation in the New Testament, what it means depends on the context. Sometimes it means that you were saved. Other times it means you're being saved. Other times it means you will be saved in the future. Sometimes it means all of those all rolled into one. You say, "What are you talking about, Jimmy?" Well, there's three aspects to salvation. There's justification, there's sanctification, and there's glorification. Now, you say, I don't know about these big words. Well, they're important. They mean something. When we talk about justification, this is past tense. This means at the moment that you got saved, you were immediately saved from the penalty of sin. God declares you innocent, and He declares you righteous. He's not going to hold your sins against you anymore. Romans 3:21, but now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified, being declared innocent, being declared righteous freely by His grace. And the word freely there means at no cost to us, because He paid all of the cost, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. So, the implication is, if you're saved, you're justified, that there's no condemnation for you, that God's not holding your sin against you anymore. You don't have to wonder whether or not you're right with God or whether or not you're going to stay saved. You've been justified. This is your position. This is who God has declared you to be. This is who you are in His sight. So you have been saved if you're in Christ. But you're being saved. We're being sanctified. And sanctified means to be set apart unto God. It happens positionally at the moment of salvation, but literally what's going on in our lives is we're progressively being saved from the power of sin in our lives. Romans 8:29, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son. In other words, God is progressively working in us to actually make us more and more like Jesus Christ. Now, what does this mean practically? Okay, think about it this way. If you're a Christian, when you blow it sometimes, it's not the end of the world because you're still being saved. You get that? You're not glorified yet. You're not perfected yet. You're still a work in progress. But at the same time, since you're being saved, it means that you can't just be the same old you that you've always been without any change and claim to be a Christian. Now, we'll get into that more next week when we're talking about works, but that's, I think, the thing that drives the world crazy about Christians. When people, people don't understand the gospel because, they think it's just, well, if you name Jesus, you can do whatever you want and be saved and everything's okay. They think that's what Christians think, which is what a lot of Christians think. But that's not what the Bible teaches. We're being saved. We're being changed. We're being sanctified. We're being delivered. God is conforming us to the image of Christ. So if you're not any different than before you got saved, you're not really saved. But you're not perfected yet, so when you blow it, you're still being saved. You can run back to the cross. But then the Bible also teaches us that someday we're going to be permanently, eternally saved from the very presence of sin. We're going to be glorified. We're going to be perfected. We're not going to sin anymore. We're going to have a resurrected, glorified body that's not going to get sick anymore. We're going to be in a perfect place in the presence of God forever and ever. Romans 8:30, moreover, whom He predestined, these He also called. Whom He called, these He also justified. Whom He justified, these He also glorified. It's as good as done. This is our hope. This is our future. What does this mean practically? Well, it means we're not in heaven yet. We're not glorified yet. We're not perfected yet. So, we haven't arrived. We're still going to struggle. We're still going to sin. We're still going to go through trials. Listen, if you think God is mad at you because you're a Christian, you're going through a trial, please think again, because we've not been glorified yet. God is using trials right now to sanctify you. And this means, it has to mean, that the prosperity gospel of health and wealth and name it and claim it and you can have whatever you want if you're a Christian can't be true, because it's confusing glorification and sanctification. It's confusing heaven and earth. We're going to experience all that in heaven. We're not going to experience it on the earth. So we have been saved. We are being saved. We will be saved. We're justified. We're sanctified. We're glorified. That's what the New Testament is talking about when it talks about salvation. So we're rescued from death to new life in Jesus Christ. Number two, salvation is a gracious gift from God. Salvation is a gracious gift from God. I mean, think about what the verse says again. For by grace you have been saved, that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. It's the gift of God. It's not of you. It's from Him. See, this is what separates Christianity from every other religion. Every other religion is the due plan. It's coming from us, our efforts, us earning it. But according to the Bible, what the cross says to us is it's what Jesus has done for us. That's why we sing, it is finished. That's what the Scripture says. Jesus paid the price in full. We're not saved by our obedience. We're saved by Jesus' obedience. We're not accepted because we obey. We obey because we're accepted. He doesn't love us because we're worthy, because we deserve it, because we've earned it. He loves us unconditionally, and then we live out of that. Grace is the fact that we deserve God to punish us, but He's chosen to bless us in Christ. Mercy is Him withholding His judgment. Grace is Him giving His blessing on top of that. Now, I think grace, it's a hard concept. I mean, it sounds good, but we're wired to think, well, this is what we deserve, right? Or this is what we need to do. Or it's too good to be true. Right? Haven't we been taught since we were kids that if something sounds too good to be true, it is? Nothing comes for free. So what is grace? Well, instead of just trying to define it, I want to illustrate it for you. I want to read you a story. It's from James Montgomery Boyce's commentary on Ephesians. And he shares the story, and then he gives an explanation of it. And it's about a social worker in England, in London, by the name of Henry Morehouse. And so the story goes like this. One evening, as he was walking along the street, he saw a little girl come out of a basement store carrying a pitcher of milk. She was taking it home, but she was a few yards away from him, and she suddenly slipped and fell. And as she fell, she dropped the pitcher. It fell on the sidewalk, milk spilled, and it shattered. And the little girl, you know, began to cry just kind of inconsolably. And so Mr. Morehouse went over to check on her to see if, you know, she was hurt and to try to calm her and, you know, get her to stop crying. But, you know, she wouldn't stop crying, and she just kept saying, "My mommy's going to whip me. My mommy's going to whip me." And so he, trying to, you know, just feel like he needed to try to do something to help with the situation, said, "No, little girl, your mother won't whip you. I'll see to that. Look, the pitcher isn't broken in that many places." And so he stooped down beside her and picked up the pieces and tried to put them back together again. And she stopped crying. Maybe she saw some hope that maybe this could be fixed. You know, she came from a poor family, and they'd had to mend pitchers before. And so she's hoping that maybe this stranger could repair the damage. And, you know, she watched as he fitted several of the pieces together. But then, you know, after a couple minutes of that, he's a little rough with it, and it fell apart again. She starts crying, saying, "My mommy's going to whip me again." And so he's like, "Okay, let's try this again." So he set out, you know, getting her help to try to put it all together. But this time, it kind of came apart in her hands. She dropped it again. She's crying. She's all upset and everything again. And finally, he's like, "You know, this isn't going to work. Need to go in a different direction." So he picked up the little girl in his arms, carried her down to a shop down the street that sold this kind of thing, and he bought her a new pitcher. Then, still carrying her, he went back to where she had bought the milk and had the new pitcher filled. He asked her where she lived. When he was told, he carried her to the house, set her down on the step, and placed the full pitcher of milk in her hands. Then he opened the door for her. As she stepped in, he asked one more question. "Now, do you think your mother will whip you?" And she lit up, smiled brightly, and said, "Oh no, sir, because it's a lot better pitcher than we had before." And here's what Boyce says about the story. Says, "Here's an illustration of the grace of God and salvation. The Bible teaches that men and women were created in the image of God. But when our first parents, Adam and Eve, sinned by disobeying God's righteous law, God's image was broken beyond repair. This does not mean that there's no value at all in human nature. Even a broken pitcher is not without value. A broken pottery is not worthless. But it is worthless so far as carrying milk is concerned. In the same way, human nature is in its broken state is useless for pleasing God or earning heaven. The Bible says there is none righteous, no, not one. There is no one who understands, no one who seeks God. All have turned away and together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Yet men keep trying to please God by their character. Like Morehouse in his first attempts to help the little girl, they keep trying to put the pieces of their broken righteousness back together. They cannot achieve God's perfect standards of righteousness, but they see parts of their character that are good from their perspective, and they try to work with those. The result is a patchwork of shards which God condemns. But here's where the grace of Almighty God comes in. The Lord Jesus came to this world, which was weeping in its failure and sin, and He became the means by which an utterly hopeless situation was transformed. There is nothing in the Bible to indicate that Jesus ever attempted to patch up fallen human nature. He did not come to assist or reform us. He came to recreate us. He said, "You must be born again." Instead of trying to piece together the broken pieces of our fallen nature, Jesus gives us a new nature. In Christ, you're a new creation, 2 Corinthians 5:17. And to paraphrase the words of the little girl, it's a lot better nature than we had before. It's nothing less than the nature of the holy and eternal God within His people. And it's all of grace. In Barnhouse's story, the little girl did not do anything to deserve Morehouse's favor. She did not pay for the new pitcher or the milk. She did not hire Morehouse's service. She had nothing to hire him with. She did not even prevail upon his sympathies because she was pretty or miserable or homely or pathetic. Morehouse did this solely because it pleased him to do it. And God saved him completely, saved us completely out of His own good pleasure. For by grace you've been saved through faith. That not of yourselves. It's the gift of God. Now, think about a gift for a minute. Shane talked about this before. We put Romans 6:23 up there. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Now, think about a gift. Shane, I'll just use you since you said that before. Let's say I want to give you a gift. Let's say I'm going to give you a new iPad, and I offer you this as a gift, and it's truly a gift. What could you say? You could say thank you. What else could you say? No, thank you. I mean, right? You can accept a gift. You can refuse a gift, right? But could he say, "I'll pay you for it," and it be a gift? Is that a gift? Gift's free, right? If it's a gift, you can't buy it. Could he say, "Well, if you give me your iPad, I'll give you one of my guitars," like it would do me any good. I mean, would that be a gift? That'd be a trade, right? Gift's free. Well, or could he say, "Well, if you give me this gift, I'll come over and I'll mow your yard, I'll clean your gutters, I'll wash your cars, I'll do a list of stuff for you, and that's the only way I'm receiving the gift." Would that be a gift? No, it'd be a wage. You'd be earning it, right? You could take a gift and then later do something or say something to say thank you, but if something's a gift, it has to be free. It can't be bought. It can't be traded for. It can't be earned. And that's what this text is saying about the grace of God. It's not from us. It's a free gift. So we can say yes to it. We can say no to it. But we can't earn it. We can't trade for it. We can't pay for it. We can't make a deal with God. We either receive God on His terms or we miss Him. For by grace you've been saved through faith. So, salvation is to be rescued from death unto life. Salvation is a gracious gift from God. But then number three, Salvation is received through faith. Salvation is received through faith. So, the medium of exchange in God's economy, Adrian Rogers used to say, is faith. Like, if I offered Shane a gift, if I'm offering him an iPad, I could reach it out to him, he could take it, and he could say thank you. That's how we would make that exchange. But what this verse is saying, what the Bible tells us from beginning to end, is if we're going to receive something from God, the way that it's going to happen is by us trusting Him. That's one of the primary themes of the Bible. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. God wants us to trust Him beyond everything else, and then everything else, our worship, our obedience, our service, flows out of trusting Him. And so, if we're going to be saved, we have to come to the place where we say yes to the grace of God by faith, which means we say no to any self-righteousness or self-effort to try to earn our own salvation. What is faith? Well, John Stott has explained it this way in the context of saving faith. He says, not works, but grace. Not law, but faith. Not our righteous deeds, but His mercy. There is no cooperation here between God and us, only a choice between two mutually exclusive ways, His and ours. Moreover, the faith which justifies, which makes us righteous, is emphatically not another work. Now, to say justification by faith is merely another way of saying justification by Christ. And then the last couple sentences are the key. Faith is absolutely no value in itself. Its value lies solely in its object. Think about it. You can, if you're trusting someone who's untrustworthy, your faith won't help you, your faith will hurt you. So the question is, who or what are we trusting in? And that applies to every area of our life, but it certainly applies spiritually. Are we trusting in Jesus? Is He trustworthy? And look at the last sentence. Faith is the eye that looks to Christ, the hand that lays hold of Him, and the mouth, not the moth, the mouth that drinks the water of life. Faith is the eye that looks to Christ, the hand that lays hold of Him, the mouth that drinks the water of life. Are you drinking the water of life? Are you holding the hand of Jesus? Are you trusting in Him? Listen, most people in East Tennessee have heard about being saved, heard that Jesus died for their sins and that He rose from the dead. But what does it really mean to trust Jesus? How do you know? Well, solid theologians and Bible scholars always said there's three elements to faith. It could be worded in different ways, but three elements to genuine faith. One, there's knowledge. You can't trust in something you don't know about. You can't believe in something that you have defective knowledge of. So it starts with our head. I mean, if you're going to receive the grace of God, if you're going to be saved, there are some things that you have to affirm as true. You have to believe that God created you, that you're accountable to Him, that you sinned against Him, that you can't save yourself, but that Jesus is the Son of God, fully man. He lived a perfect and a sinless life. He died for your sins. He rose from the dead. He is the only way to God. The salvation is in trusting Him. If you intellectually affirm those things, that in and of itself does not make you a Christian, because the Bible says the demons believe and tremble, but it's a first step. But there's a couple of other elements that have to be added to genuine faith. Here's the second, is heart response. You have to actually trust in Jesus Christ and Him alone for the forgiveness of your sins. That God, by His Spirit, has to do a work of regeneration in your heart, where He takes a heart of stone and makes it a heart of flesh, where He makes you spiritually alive and gives you a love for, a dependence on Jesus Christ. Listen, to be East Tennessee saved instead of really saved is to pray a prayer and believe something in your head and think you can go live the rest of your life however you want to live and have a fire insurance policy. That's not what the Bible is talking about here. There has to be a heart response. And then there has to be a commitment to Christ. Jesus said, repent and believe the gospel. Repent means to turn away from our sin and turn to God. Romans 10:9 says, if you believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead and you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. Confessing that Jesus is Lord is affirming, yes, that He's God, but you're saying, you're my God, you're my Lord, you're my boss. It's indicating a commitment of life to Him. It's bowing before Him and giving Him our lives. We just can't come to Jesus once again, pray a prayer, get a fire insurance policy, and everything be cool. There's knowledge, but there's heart response, and there's commitment. Ultimately, faith is taking God at His word and acting on it. It's putting all of our weight on Jesus Christ. It's putting all of our eggs in that basket, so to speak, where if the Bible's not true and if Jesus is who He isn't who He says He is, that I'm doomed, because that's where my hope and dependence and trust is. Are you relying on Christ and Christ alone to forgive you of your sins, to save you, to make you right with God? Or do you need to take God at His word today? Do you need to take Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, and rest on, rely in, trust in Jesus Christ? Okay, I want to show you a video clip and basically end with this, and then I want to give you a chance to respond. This is from the Indiana Jones series of movies, and I think it's a great illustration of what faith really is. The truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The bridge that connects sinful men and women to a holy God is the cross of Christ. But we have to take a step of faith, trusting that He's going to catch us and hold us and save us and forgive us and give us new life. Have you taken that step of faith? Are you trusting in Christ, in the grace of God, His death on the cross, His resurrection, and that alone for the forgiveness of your sins and for giving you spiritual life? If not, His invitation today is to stop trusting in yourself, to stop going your own way, to repent, to turn to Him, to trust in Him, to believe in Him in your heart, to confess Him with your mouth, to commit your life to Him. And I'm going to give you the opportunity to do that right now. If you would, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. grace. It's a free gift that God's offering you. You can say yes or you can say no. You can't trade for it, can't buy it, you can't work for it. You can reject it or you can receive it by receiving Jesus by faith. Right now, I want to encourage you that if you believe this in your head, God's giving you by His Spirit the ability in your heart to respond to Him. To with your mouth confess the faith that God's giving you in your heart. If you need to receive Christ, you need to receive His grace today. I encourage you to ask Him to forgive you of your sins, to ask Him to come into your life, to commit your life to Him, trusting Him as your Lord and your Savior. If you need help in expressing that to God, you can pray something like this. As long as you're talking to God, as long as you mean it, as you believe it, if you want to receive Christ, you pray something like this, if you mean it from your heart. Can be your words. Just pray something like this. Dear God, I admit that I'm a sinner. Lord, I need You. Jesus, I can't save myself. And I ask You to forgive me. Lord, I ask for Your grace in my life. I trust You. I believe that You're the Son of God. Believe that You died for my sins. And I believe that You rose from the dead. Right now, by faith, I receive You into my life as my Lord and my Savior. I commit my life to You, to follow You. Lord, cleanse me and change me and make me who You want me to be. I want to encourage you to do something. If you just place your faith in Christ, and prayer is not magical. We believe in our heart, we confess with our mouth. I encourage you to come and talk to me or share it with someone you know or fill out your connection card that's in your bulletin and check the appropriate blank and turn it in one of the offering boxes by the doors in the back. Or if you've got questions, check that blank on your connection card. Or come see me or somebody else that you feel comfortable with and let us help you make sure that this is settled in your life, because there's nothing more valuable, there's nothing more wonderful than the grace of God. Don't say no to it. I'm going to pray for us, and then Preston Ford, one of our elders, is going to come share something with us and lead us in prayer to close us out. Father, we thank You for Your wonderful, matchless, marvelous, amazing grace. And Lord, I pray that there would be nobody that would leave here today without trusting Jesus and without saying yes to that offer. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.